Hofmeister.
Thank you.
I hope you have a pleasant evening today. I would like to thank Dr. Chauhan and all the esteemed Physician Forum members who have spared some time out for the today's CME. So coming on to the context, a few months back we had our first CME with the Physician Forum. That time we had a pure pediatric topic, which was vision disorders in infancy and childhood. So this time we picked up two topics from other two specialties of our hospital, one from the gynae ops and the other from the pediatric surgery unit. So they'll be sensitizing everybody on the common gynecological problems and the common pediatric surgery problems which we as practitioners would often encounter in our day-to-day practice. The relevance of this two topics can be understood by the fact that the conditions which we will be touching on, they are very common in our day-to-day practice, and the management of many of these conditions comprises of a good counseling, a very close follow-up with some medical aspect to the management, and not all of these surgical or gynecological conditions may or may not need a surgical intervention. So as general practitioners, if we have an insight into these conditions, it would be of real help to timely pick up these conditions and appropriate management of these conditions. For example, if I pick up one common condition from the gynecological aspect, is cervical cancer. So cervical cancer, as we all know, it's one of the most common cancers affecting women, and if my stats are right, almost like 120,000 females get affected every year, so that comes to around almost like 10,000 females in a month, so which is like almost like 300 cases in a day, roughly around that figure. And unfortunately, half of the women die, and pap smear screening is one of the biggest tools to reduce the disease burden in India. Similarly, in the pediatric surgery arena, if we think of common conditions like inguinal hernia, undescended testes, they may be very commonly missed and ignored even by parents. And if they are not timely picked up, even surgical interventions may not be able to give the desired therapeutic results, to the extent that fertility might get affected, testicular malignancy might be seen on follow-ups. So working knowledge of these issues is definitely required. So without taking much of a time, I would like to hand over the mic to Dr. Shireen to take the evening forward from here.
Today we are into another Wednesday CME. Today we will discuss about gynecological problems. Let me introduce the speaker, Dr. Aparna Mundana. She has done her MBBS and MS from Mumbai and senior residency from DDU. Now she is a practicing gynecologist and obstetrician in South Delhi. She is attached to Triton and Forties Laughing. She is an upcoming budding gynecologist in South Delhi. She will talk about common gynecological problems which are useful for general practitioners. I welcome you, Doctor.
Thank you, Shri, for the introduction. Today I am going to cover gynecological problems and can we help them. So the problems which I am going to discuss is discharge PV. So first, starting with discharge PV, we should know what is normal healthy vaginal discharge and what is abnormal vaginal discharge. Normal vaginal discharge is clear, whitish in color with a slight odor which leaves a tinge on the undergarments and changes in consistency throughout the menstrual cycle. Abnormal vaginal discharge is something which is changes in color, which can be yellow, green, gray. It can resemble cottage cheese in color and can cause vaginal itchiness. It could be foamy, frothy, and sometimes has a strong smell, fishy odor. Now, regarding how can we diagnose the various vaginal discharges is by the color. So, what is clear vaginal discharge is when it's a healthy discharge. It can be seen in pregnancy, ovulation, hormonal imbalance. White color discharge is corresponding to yeast infection. Yellow color yellow to green color is corresponding to sexually transmitted diseases, gray color is bacterial vaginosis, pink is cervical bleeding, vaginal irritation, implantation bleeding, and red is menstruation, cervical infection, cervical polyp, endometrial and cervical cancer. Now, to the most common causes of vaginal discharge, it could be infective, which is non-sexually transmitted, which is bacterial vaginosis and candida. Infective cases are sexually transmitted, will be chlamydia, neisseria, trichomonas and herpes. And there are a lot of non-infective reasons for vaginal discharge, which can be a foreign body, a cervical polyp ectopia, genital tract malignancy, fistula and allergic reactions. We come across this term very commonly, which is called as leucorrhea. What is it? It is something which causes vaginal moistness, staining of the undergarments. It is non-irritant, non-pruritic, and it is more or less caused because of the increase in estrogen. The treatment is only reassurance, local hygiene, and general health. Now we come to three main causes of vaginal discharge, which is bacterial vaginosis. Very characteristic of bacterial vaginosis is the fishy odor it causes, and it is a milky white to gray in color. Yeast infection is white, thick white cottage cheese, and most important factor is the itching and the burning irritation which it causes. And trichomonas is a frothy yellow greenish discharge and has a musty odor. Now regarding the treatment of each of the discharges, vulvovaginal candidiasis looks like something like this and can be treated by clotrimazole and by oral antifungals. Bacterial vaginosis looks something like this and can be treated with metronidazole, clindamycin. Here, routine treatment of the partner is not recommended. Trichomonas vaginitis looks like this and can be treated by metronidazole, clindamycin, and a sexual partner has to be treated along with the female patient. Now, a vaginal infection which passes further on into the uterus causes pelvic inflammatory diseases. So, which can be acute, subacute and chronic, and a lot of organisms cause these infections. The pathogenesis is cervicitis causing endometritis, causing salpingo-oophoritis, and finally causing a tubo-ovarian abscess and finally leading to peritonitis. So what are the signs and symptoms of PID? Lower abdominal pain and pelvic pain, heavy vaginal discharge with a very foul odor because it is infectious, irregular menstrual cycles, heavy pain during intercourse, pain in the lower back, fever, fatigue, diarrhea, vomiting, and difficulty when passing urine and painful urination. Now how do we come to a diagnosis? PID is diagnosed clinically by doing a pervaginal examination where we elicit a cervical motion tenderness, uterine tenderness and adnexal tenderness, along with a high grade fever of more than 101 degrees Fahrenheit, abnormal cervical vaginal mucopurulent discharge, elevated ESRC reactive protein, and the organisms can be isolated on the discharge. Regarding acute and chronic PID, acute PID is highly virulent. It is a generalized infection and occurs, and there are recurrent episodes of this. Whereas chronic PID will take months and years, the progression will be leading to an organ damage. Now, what is the reason why we have to hospitalize patients with PID? Will be when there is an inability to follow or tolerate an outpatient oral medication regime, when there is no response to any oral antimicrobial therapy, pregnancy, when there is severe illness with high grade fever, or there is a tubo-ovarian abscess. And what surgeries can be performed in PID? In acute PID, we perform a surgery only when there is a ruptured abscess, and in chronic PID, it is done so as to relieve the adhesions caused because of the process. It could be elicited as severe progressive pain, or if there are repeated exacerbations of PID, and when there are bilateral abscesses more than 8 cm in diameter. Now this is the CDC recommendations for parenteral as well as parenteral regimes for severe PID and for mild to moderate PID. Now this is all about vaginal discharge finally leading to PID and finally leading to complications. Now we come on to what is bleeding PV. Now bleeding PV has now been nomenclatured as abnormal uterine bleeding. Now what is abnormal uterine bleeding? Abnormal uterine bleeding is something where the frequency, now we come on to what is normal uterine bleeding, is where the frequency of menses happens every 24 to 48 days. So the cycle length is 38 days, when the duration of flow lasts for 4.5 to 8 days, and when the monthly blood loss is in the range of 20 to 80 ml. Any deviation from this is abnormal uterine bleeding. Now, to diagnose AUB, which is abnormal uterine bleeding, FIGO has come up with a classification called as palm coin. So what is palm coin? P stands for polyp. So these are etiological factors for causing abnormal uterine bleeding. It is important to diagnose or nomenclature it in the form of AUB so that the treatment becomes easy. Now AUB, P-A-L, P-A-L-M, C-O-E-I-L. So it will be P for polyp, A for adenomyosis, L for leiomyoma, M for malignancy, C for coagulopathy, O for ovulatory dysfunction, E for endometrial causes, I will be iatrogenic, and N will be not yet classified. So if I have a patient who has a cervical polyp, so I would label her as AUB, that is abnormal uterine bleeding, and I write P, so that is because of a polyp. If there is a leiomyoma, it will be AUBM. Now what are the investigations we do? Any patient who comes with an abnormal uterine bleeding, we should always do a pregnancy test because we cannot afford to miss an ectopic pregnancy. So any patient with an AUB, we should do a pregnancy test, a complete blood count and a coagulation profile. Other investigations will be ultrasound, endometrial biopsy and hysteroscopy and DNC. Now regarding DNC, endometrial histopathology is very important. Now when do we do endometrial histopathology? All patients of AUB who are more than 40 years of age, we are supposed to do endometrial histopathology, and ladies who are lesser than 40 years of age and those who have high risk for CA endometrium, we should do them. So who are patients who are high risk for CA endometrium will be obesity, diabetes, hypertension, people who have endometrial thickness is more than 12 mm. So instead of doing a DNC, the recommendation now is to do an endometrial aspiration, which is an OPD procedure, and it is done by special pipette which is shown here and can be done as an OPD procedure. And if the histopathology is inadequate by the normal endometrial aspiration, then we do a hysteroscopy DNC. Now we come into individual cases of AUB. Polyp, how is polyp seen? Polyp is seen as in a normal sized uterus, but the polyp is visually seen at the mouth of the cervix. It causes prolonged bleeding, intermenstrual bleeding and pallor and infertility. And treatment will be hysteroscopic surgical removal. Now what do we do for adenomyosis? Now what is adenomyosis? Adenomyosis is a uniformly enlarged uterus. So here the whole thickness of the uterine wall will be more. So there will be a thick uterine wall. Endometrial junction will be hypoechoic and endometrium will be heterogeneous. And what do we do for this? We would either use a LMG IUS, which is a levonorgestrel intrauterine system. We can treat her by giving her oral medication, or we can do surgical procedures for her. Now what is the leiomyoma? Leiomyoma in layman language is a fibroid uterus. Now leiomyoma may be symptomatic, may not be symptomatic. I have a slide further for to explain you the various locations for a myomas. Now what happens in this? The uterus becomes irregularly enlarged. In adenomyosis, we had a uniformly enlarged uterus, but in the leiomyoma, it will be an irregularly enlarged uterus, and it will be picked up in an ultrasound. Treatment would be either medical, which will be tranexamic acid, hormones, or surgical procedures like myomectomy and hysterectomy. Then we come into malignancy. The most common symptom of a malignancy will be postmenopausal bleeding or irregular bleeding at the time of perimenopause. And here the uterus will be enlarged and the mobility will be restricted because of the spread of the malignancy to the neighboring organs. Here the endometrium will be thick, which will be more than 12 mm, irregular endometrial lining, and the endomyometrial junction will be damaged. Treatment is again surgical. Now we come to the other causes of causing AUB, that is COEIL. Coagulopathy is mostly seen in puberty, that is pubertal menorrhagia. Here the patient will have other features of a bleeding disorder, will have easy bruisability, petechiae, and can be managed by an oral medication. Ovulatory disorder is PCO, which I'll be dealing with in the next slides. Here the uterus will be of a normal size and mostly will be treated by a medically. Endometrial will be intermenstrual prolonged spotting and again will be treated by medical management. Iatrogenic AUB is mostly copper T. Copper T causes iatrogenic AUB. and the treatment will be removal, and the non-classified, and the etiology for the non-classified AUB is mostly AVM, that is arterial venous malformations. Now regarding PCO, we get a lot of patients who come with an ultrasound showing PCO, but it is diagnosed as PCO only when there are more than 12 follicles in one ovary, and each follicle should be a minimum of 12 to 9 millimeters, and the ovarian volume should be more than 10 centimeters. So we get a lot of PCOD patients who have an ultrasound guide, who come with us to an ultrasound showing that they are PCO, but not all the ultrasounds should be labeled as PCO. They should have all these features. Now, how do we diagnose PCOS? PCOS is a clinical diagnosis. Not all patients who have PCO should have the ultrasound picture of PCO. So what does Rotterdam tell us? Rotterdam tells me that there are three criteria to label a patient as PCO. First is clinical or biochemical hyperandrogenism. Second is oligoamenorrhea anovulation. And the third criteria is PCO appearance on ultrasound. Two out of the three features to diagnose a patient as PCO. So even if an ultrasound is not showing PCO, but there is clinical biochemical hyperandrogenism and there is oligoamenorrhea anovulation, then I can label my patient as PCO. Purely clinical diagnosis and does not require an ultrasound to diagnose PCOS. Similarly, the AEPCOS definition also comes to the same thing. Here, the androgen excess, they have made androgen excess should be a criteria. And then among the oligoamenorrhea anovulation and PCO, either one of it should be present to diagnose the patient as PCOS. Now, how do I treat PCOS? PCOS has to be treated by lifestyle modification. All the patients should be advised lifestyle modification. Patients of PCO with infertility, we give ovulation induction. Those who present to us with AUB should be given medical or surgical management. Patients can present with hirsutism, acne are also given medical management. Now regarding the fibroids. So how do we classify fibroids? Fibroids which are purely in the mucosa are called as submucosal fibroids. Those which are seen in the wall of the uterus are intramural and subserosal. Generally, submucosal fibroids cause symptoms and subserosal fibroids do not cause any symptoms. So treatment of fibroid uterus is always according to the patient's symptoms. And doesn't depend upon the size of the fibroid. A very small submucosal fibroid will cause a lot of symptoms, but a very large subserosal fibroid will not cause any symptoms. So we need to treat them according to the symptoms and according to the her need to retain fertility, her need to retain her uterus or not. Now that is all about abnormal uterine bleeding. Now we come to major causes of lower abdominal pain. So what is it? It could be cholecystitis, urinary tract infection, appendicitis, endometritis, miscarriages, dysmenorrhea, PCO, fibroids and pelvic inflammatory diseases. So like I told you, every patient who comes with a lower abdominal pain, I have to do a pregnancy test. I cannot miss an ectopic at any point in my career. So I do a pregnancy test. If it comes positive, I do an ultrasound and diagnose her either as a normal pregnancy or as an ectopic pregnancy. Now, if she complains of a right lower quadrant abdominal pain or a pain which is migrating from the umbilical area to the right lower quadrant, then it is mostly appendicitis or surgical causes for lower abdominal pain. And still, if I do a pervaginal examination, I get a cervical motion tenderness, then it is most probably a case of PID. Now, what is amenorrhea? There are two types of amenorrhea, either it is primary or secondary. Primary amenorrhea is absence of menses in a 14-year-old girl, but she also has no secondary sexual characteristics. Then she is primary amenorrhea. She is primary amenorrhea even if she is 16 years of age, but she has the secondary sexual characteristics. Now, secondary amenorrhea, there are lots of causes for secondary amenorrhea. Most commonest cause of secondary amenorrhea is pregnancy, lactation, emotional stress, malnutrition, and not all these causes need to be evaluated and treated, because many of them will be physiological and many of them will be hormonal changes. So hormonal things we still want to treat, but physiological like breastfeeding causing amenorrhea, pregnancy, depression, everything has its own individual treatment. Now how do we assess a patient of amenorrhea? We should do an ultrasound, a pregnancy test, thyroid function test, prolactin levels. Now, if her follicular stimulating hormone is high, it indicates an ovarian failure, that is premature ovarian failure. If the levels of LH are high, then it is gonadal dysfunction. We can also do a laparoscopy and a CT scan. Now we come to pruritus bulbae. It could be generalized or localized. Localized is candidiasis, scabies, psoriasis, parasitic infestations with pinworm, pediculosis, discharge from anus, piles, fissures, fecal incontinences. I'm trying to include the topics which we normally, or conditions which we normally see in our OPD practice. So we do see a lot of pruritus bulba, and each of the etiology has its own treatment. Now we come into a lot of swellings in the vulva. So what causes swellings in the vulva? It could be infections like viral warts, most commonly HPV infection, syphilis, abscesses. Now this is Bartholin's gland cyst, which is a retention cyst. It could be a sebaceous cyst and can also be a Wolfian duct remnant. Trauma causing a hematoma, genital prolapse. Now a little about genital prolapse here. Genital prolapse is various degrees of genital prolapse. First degree is when the cervix has descended into the vagina but not reaching the external laws. Second degree is when it reaches the external laws. Third degree is when it has gone beyond the external laws. And fourth or precedentia is when the whole uterus comes out. Now again, treatment for uterine prolapse again depends upon the patient's wish to preserve her uterus or not, and according to her gravidas status. Now if the patient wants to preserve her uterus, what we do is an abdominal surgeries or laparoscopic abdominal surgeries, where we do sling surgeries where we pull up the uterus. If she is not desirous of pregnancy and she does not want to conserve her uterus according to her age, we can do a vaginal hysterectomy and do a anterior and posterior repair so that the cystocele and the rectocele are also treated simultaneously. Other causes of lumps and swellings are benign malignant tumors and urethral carotids. Now, adenexal masses. So what is adenexa? Adenexa is any organ, is the ovary, the fallopian tubes and the remaining and the adjacent organs is all called as an adenexal mass. Now, adenexa is a common gynecological problem. 5 to 10% lifetime risk. Adenexal masses may be found in females of all the age groups, from fetuses till elderly. Wide variety of types of masses are seen in adenexa because the ovary is there, and it could be symptomatic or it could be only discovered incidentally on an examination or an imaging. Now, important thing to know in this case is what are benign lesions and what are malignant lesions in the adenexa. Benign lesions are lesions which are simple cysts. They are less than 10 centimeters in size. The septations, if there are septations, they have to be less than 3 mm in thickness. They are generally unilateral swellings. There could be calcifications. Malignant cysts are those which are solid cystic. They have multiple septations more than 3 mm in size. There are bilateral and there could be associated ascites along with it. Common causes of cysts are simple cysts, hemorrhagic cysts, endometriomas, mature cystic teratomas or malignant tumors. Now again, differentiating benign with suspicious lesions. Here, free fluid Doppler PI is more in case of benign and less in case of suspicious lesions. Now we should know what are follicular cysts, because we get a lot of ultrasound showing simple follicular cysts. And though, how do we treat them? A simple follicular cyst is a functional cyst. So a functional cyst, which is more than 3 centimeters in diameter, it could be only an incidental finding or we could see it on a pelvic examination. And this cyst is a retention cyst. It is a functional cyst. So it will resolve in 4 to 8 weeks without any treatment. So it is important to know what are benign cysts and what are malignant cysts. Now, as Dr. Anuj has said, we should always do a cervical cancer screening, and a lot of cervical cancer burden on the society. So what do? We do a cervical smear. Now traditionally, we would do a pap smear by a spatula. Now we do what is called as a liquid-based cytology, which has a much better yield to the diagnosis. So what do? So time for a pap smear. So when do we do a pap smear? Women who are less than 21 years of age, we do not do any cervical cancer screening. Women aged in between 21 to 29, cytology has to be done every 3 years. It is a very simple test to be done once in 3 years to diagnose cervical cancer or the pre-malignant condition. Women in the age of 30 to 65 years, we are supposed to do what is called as a co-testing, where we do the cytology along with the HPV DNA. Now, because more or less 97% of all the cervical cancer is caused by HPV DNA, so that association is there, and this test needs to be done once in 5 years. If you do a co-testing, if you do cytology alone, then it is every 3 years. Women who are older than 65 years of age and who have undergone prior screening and have been termed negative, they need not be screened further. Women who have undergone total hysterectomy with the cervix removed, they don't need any screening. Women who are vaccinated against HPV, they will still have the routine screening done. Thank you.
Dr. Anuj Gupta is an intensivist trained in PGIMR after doing his MD from pediatrics in Maulana Azad Medical College. And Dr. Anand Sinha is an MCH pediatric surgeon trained at AIMS. No pediatrician or even a general physician looking after kids cannot survive without having a backup with a pediatric surgeon. There are very common pediatric problems like lump abdomen, neck, pyloric stenosis, undescended testes, phimosis, to name a few common problems we see in day-to-day life. And we do need a backup from pediatric surgeons. I invite Dr. Anuj Gupta and Dr. Anand Sinha to present their slide.
Today, me and Dr. Anand will be touching up on the common neonatal and pediatric surgical conditions which any doctor, be of any specialty, might encounter just by chance in a day-to-day practice. Other group of disorders in which surgery may or may not be required or might be required at some point of time. And there is the third category of disorders in which surgery would definitely be required and maybe as and when these conditions are picked up. So, like, the common problems which we as practitioners might encounter in office practice are a child coming with groin swellings or with umbilical swellings, constipation, bleeding per rectum. So, I will be touching upon the groin swellings and the umbilical swellings. Then a child might also come with recurrent vomitings, abdominal pain and swellings and cysts. So, these will be covered by Dr. Anand Sinha. So these are the common neonatal surgical problems like brachioesophageal fistula, congenital diaphragmatic hernias, intestinal atresia, valvulus, anal atresia, which we commonly encounter, and obviously these neonatal conditions would require surgery as the only intervention. So there are certain myths and facts, there are certain statements which would come to our minds, and sometimes even parents would be carrying these statements in mind. Some of them might be actually a myth, some of them might be actual facts and true. So, like, one of them is umbilical hernia should be operated as and when detected, because these are hernias. Umbilical hernias should be strapped. This is a very common situation which personally I have seen many parents doing it. Inguinal hernia should be operated as and when detected. Umbilical granulomas should be surgically excised. I will be coming to these individual conditions in the subsequent slides. Unilateral undescended testes should be investigated and surgically corrected irrespective of age. Unilateral undescended testes should be corrected between 6 months till 1 year of age. So these are the common things which would come to our minds whenever we see a case with either umbilical hernia or inguinal hernias or granulomas or undescended testes. So which one of them is a myth, which one of them is a fact, I would try to cover them in my subsequent slides. So first of all, coming to one of the very common problems which we would encounter in office practice is umbilical hernia. So it's nothing but the outpouching of the abdominal viscera through the umbilical ring, and it is skin covered. It would appear something like this as an umbilical swelling protruding out, might be slightly smaller with a wider base and might be with a smaller base and more protruding. And it has been seen that it's commonly seen in infants as early as 1 to 2 months of age, and over the period of infancy it can become bigger in size, but they have been found to spontaneously regress in the next 1.5 years. Most of them will regress by 2 to 3 years of age. They would hardly cause any problems to the baby in terms of refusal to feed or pain or vomitings. they are generally asymptomatic, just except for the cosmetically they would be visible. So a very common thing which parents do, because it is being run in families, is that they would strap it with the help of a coin which is covered in the cloth. So that practice is no more advised, and since it has been shown to cause obstruction to the viscera. So the other condition which we often see even in a newborn is diastasis recti. So this is what is diastasis recti. So you see a longitudinal bulge in the center, and this is basically because of the laxity of the abdominal musculature. And again, this is asymptomatic, does not bother the baby, and it has been seen that over the next period of time, few months, it is going to disappear as the abdominal musculature becomes more stronger. So many of the parents would be really bothered that again this is something like a hernia. If they put a finger over this area, they would feel some gurgling sounds. What needs to be done, whether it will affect the intestines? So nothing has to be done, this will disappear. Only counseling and close follow-up is to be done. Coming to umbilical granuloma, so this is what it looks like. It's basically a granulation tissue when the umbilical cord falls up, falls off in the newborn period. What you sometimes get in some babies would be a this type of a picture, a reddish mass type of a thing, which might be slightly, it might give out some serous fluid, and it can be slightly light yellowish or pinkish in nature. It might appear a bit yellowish, but it is non-infective, does not need to be treated with antibiotics, or no surgical intervention has to be done. Again, it could be handled very easily in office practice by any practitioner. Sometimes if it wets the clothes quite often, then either 1% silver nitrate or some topical steroid cream can be applied. So coming to the groin swellings, inguinal hernia is one of the most common groin swellings which we encounter. Hydrocele, undescended testis, and inguinal lymphadenopathy also is one of the groin swellings which is kept as a differential diagnosis. So what are the frequently asked questions when we encounter a child with hernia? How common is it? It is not very uncommon. It's in fact the commonest pediatric surgical problem. Incidence is 4%, and it goes up to 20% in the premature babies. More common in males. So very often, since it is just a apparently cosmetic issue, many of the parents might feel, or they might be counseled by somebody, that chhod do, it might disappear with time. Bachcha to khel raha hai, it's not causing any feeding problems. So when should I get my child operated is the next common question. So advice is to get it operated as soon as feasible. Reason being, many of them, they might become obstructed over the next few months. And if it becomes obstructed, the surgery is riskier, recurrence is higher, and the child's health usually becomes a cause of worry. And most obstructions, that is 70% of them, happen in the less than 1 year olds. How major is the surgery? It's very safe, very routinely done, and it's not a very long surgery, maybe lasting up to half an hour or so. And it can often be managed as a daycare procedure. So coming to the next common condition which we see is hydrocele. It is nothing but collection of fluid around the testicles. So when should I get my child operated? This particular condition, it is known to regress with time in certain situations. So immediate surgical intervention may not be required. So in office practice, we can counsel, reassure the family that if it is not causing significant discomfort to the baby, if it is not increasing with time, then we can just keep a close follow-up and maybe follow up the baby every 1 to 2 months. So spontaneous resolution is known, but excluding hernia is a must, because sometimes both of them might coexist. Surgery is same as for hernia, inguinal herniotomy. So clinical differentiation of the two is very important, because both these two conditions is more often than not a clinical diagnosis. Hernia is, this swelling reduces itself spontaneously, whereas hydrocele might reduce, but gradually, and usually does not resolve completely or does not get reduced completely. A hernia would almost always have an inguinal component, whereas a hydrocele may be only scrotal. So if it's just a scrotal swelling without any inguinal element to it, it is going to be a hydrocele, and we may not push the parents to actually go in for a investigative workup or again for a surgery.
So these are a few of the inguinal swellings which we commonly encounter. So like this has a inguinal testicular swelling along with the inguinal component, so looks like a hernia. So this one does not have, on the other hand, a inguinal element. So this is like a hydrocele. And a conventional test which is often done is to do a transillumination test. So hydrocele swelling, for obvious reasons, will transilluminate. So again, this is a testicular swelling with an inguinal element, looks like a hernia. So this is what is a communicating hydrocele, the pathogenesis of which is the patent processus vaginalis. So since this is patent, the peritoneal fluid gets accumulated around the testicles. The other variant is the non-communicating one, because of which we say that a hydrocele may not always have an inguinal element. So you just see a testicular swelling without any inguinal swelling. So this is what it would look like, and again, as I told you in the previous slide. So coming to the undescended testis, now this is again very important. Now the incidence is 1% to around 5% in full-term babies, and rates as high as 45% in the preterm babies. Now the failure or delay of treatment, what would it cause? It would can result in reduced fertility and or increased testicular cancer risk in adulthood. This congenital malformation may affect both sides in up to 30% of cases. The treatment should be started at the age of 6 months, meaning to say that many of the undescended testes, they would descend in the subsequent months. So we can safely wait till around 6 months of age, because they are known to descend spontaneously. Undescended testes rarely descends after this age. So 6 months is taken as the cutoff beyond which we have to start thinking of and start counseling the family towards a surgical intervention. Any kind of treatment leading to a scrotally positioned testis should be finished by 12 months or 18 months at the latest, because even if we do think of a surgical correction beyond this period, cosmetically you might bring the testicles down, but the damage might have already been done. So the things to be highlighted are that it's not very uncommon in terms, especially in preterms. The till 6 months of age, we actually don't need to do anything, just a close follow up, and then 12 months should be, in fact, the age cutoff for surgical intervention is coming down to even 9 months now. So, and this particular condition is, as I told you initially, is very commonly missed even by the parents. So, it's not unusual for a parent or even for a practitioner to accidentally detect it when the child is coming in for a routine vaccination. The parents would not have noticed it. When the practitioner notices it that the baby is having undescended testis, only that when it comes to attention. So these are the common locations of undescended testis. So it could be intra-abdominal, it could be in the inguinal canal, and it could be in the suprascrotal region. Suppose we are dealing with a case of undescended testis and we don't find testis in the inguinal canal or the suprascrotal region. It could be either be intra-abdominal, or we should always think of the other entity, which is the ectopic testis. The testis may not always be along the path of descent. It could have migrated to some nearby sites, which commonly could be either the suprapubic region, it could be even in the femoral area, it could be somewhere in the perineal area, or it could have migrated to the other side of the scrotum. So this is what it might look like, a small swelling in the perineal area, and similarly in this picture. So if you are dealing with the case of undescended testis, what do we look for? Whether it is palpable or it is non-palpable. So first step is to actually try to palpate the testis. So if it's a palpable testis, it could be either in the inguinal canal, or if it is not in the inguinal canal, it could be a reptile testis, or it could be a palpable testis. Again, inguinal testis might be a possibility, because some testis present in the inguinal canal can be clinically missed. It could be again ectopic, which can be commonly missed and may not be palpable. It could be an intra-abdominal variety, or a fourth possibility could be an absent testis because of either agenesis or the vanishing testis situation would have been there. So this is actually the management of the unilateral non-palpable testis. I think Dr. Anand will shall cover in his presentation. So coming back to the myths and facts. So as I had initially told, umbilical hernia should be operated as and when detected. So this is actually a myth. So these are harmless. They are known to spontaneously regress. Umbilical hernia should be strapped. Very obvious. No, it's a myth. Inguinal hernia should be operated as and when detected. Yes, it's a fact. It should be detected. It should be operated as and when detected. Umbilical granuloma should be surgically excised. It's a myth. Unilateral undescended testes should be investigated and surgically corrected irrespective of age. It's a myth because we know that undescended testes can descend down till around 6 months of age. Unilateral undescended testes should be corrected between 6 months till 1 year of age. So this is a fact, yes. Between 6 months till 1 year, we should think of doing a corrective surgery to bring the testes down. So I would like to invite Dr. Anand, who's been our pillar of strength in the pediatric surgery. We've been doing a lot of pediatric work because of our intensive care services, but obviously without a good pediatric surgeon, even the intensive care services cannot do anything. So I think he'll carry it forward from here.
Firstly, I would like to thank Dr. Anuj for having me here. He has had me for 4 years, tolerated me. He has made my job easier with this presentation. Also, he has covered most of the prominent topics that we commonly encounter. But apart from that, he has made my job easy when I operate here. He has provided excellent intensive care. I am very comfortable when the child is here. Even small units that we have done here, I have done really well. And he has provided me an opportunity to stand here and speak in front of you. I understand that I am coming between you and dinner, which is getting late already. I'll try to finish off as soon as possible. So the laparoscopy for appendix, for fundoplications, for undescended testes. We deal with a lot of urology. We deal with all kinds of swellings in the kidney. We deal with vesicular reflux, urinary tract infections. We also deal with tumors. We have operated a few tumors here as well. Then we do reconstructive surgeries like hypospadias, endometrial malformations, Hirschsprung disease. In neonates, we do diaphragmatic hernias, visual atresias, intestinal atresias, and other things as well. Apart from this, there are some cold cases that come to us and that we deal with, like cleft lip palates, syndactyly, and some amount of neurosurgery, just the basic neurosurgery in form of meningomyelocele also we deal. Now, these are few of the cases that we have done here. They have done really well. Again, thanks to Dr. Anuj for providing such good care and the anesthesia care as well here. We have done tracheostomy fistulas, diaphragmatic hernias, intestinal atresias. These are all patients that we have done here. Then we have done a lot of neonatal emergencies. Apart from this, this is one of the rare tumors that we had operated. This was a 1-year-old kid who had a tumor in the intestine, which turned out to be a myofibroblastic tumor that we had done here. Apart from that, again, a lot of cases that we do here with very satisfactory results. Now, I'll just emphasize a few points that children are not actually small adults. There are a lot of differences when you're operating with children. Your operating temperature is different. We are actually sweating when we operate. You compare it to a cardiac OT, which is 18 degrees, or an orthopedic OT, it is quite different. Anatomic variations are there. The subcutaneous fat is less. There is a lot of chances of going into hypothermia. There are various congenital anomalies which can distort the anatomy that you are dealing with. So you have to be careful about it. The diseases are also different. For example, you get a rectal bleed in an adult patient, you start thinking of a malignancy, while in a child it is invariably not so. And the procedures are also different. For example, when you are operating a hernia, in adults you put in a mesh, while in child it is just a herniotomy, putting a single suture on the deep ring and it finishes off the job. So there are quite a lot of differences in children, and that is why we have evolved as a specialty in pediatric surgery. These are the common problems, some of them Dr. Anuj has already dealt with. I'll start with something which comes very commonly, acute abdomen. There are a lot of reasons for this. There are a lot of non-surgical causes as well. These are the surgical conditions which can cause pain in abdomen. And we need to understand what of them happen. The commonest ones I'll deal with, like acute appendicitis. It is very common, even in small kids, 1 year, 2 years old, we have done appendicitis. So it is not uncommon, should be thought of when you get a child who has a classical triad of pain in abdomen, fever and vomiting. Your total count will be raised, your CRP will be raised, you have tenderness in the right side of abdomen. In children, it might not be very easy to localize it, but definitely you can find tenderness in the right side of the lower abdomen. And the treatment, irrespective of the age, you can do a laparoscopic appendectomy. It is a pretty safe procedure. Within 24 to 48 hours, you can discharge the patient very safely. Then you come to pyloric stenosis, something which gets commonly missed as a child vomiting again and again. But if the child is having recurrent vomiting, projectile vomiting, losing weight or not gaining weight, is getting dehydrated, we should start thinking of a pyloric stenosis. An ultrasound will tell us with the various parameters, and a very simple surgery can cure pyloric stenosis. Interception, again one common thing which you can miss if you get a pain in abdomen child. Classical will be child crying a lot, then becoming quiet for a while, then again crying a lot. So this is a typical colicky pain. Then he will have something as a red currant jelly stool. This is again classical for interception. The age is also a pointer. It will be somewhere between 6 months to 2 years, somewhere around 1 year of age when the child is being weaned. And sometimes we are able to just hydrostatically reduce it with pushing in barium, or you can push in air also. This is the claw sign that you can see. This is the interception which has come into the colon, and with the barium we are trying to push it, and usually we are able to successfully do it. But sometimes you do have to resort to surgery. So this is one of the interceptions that we had done here. Here you can see that the bowel is entering into the distal bowel, and that was just successfully reduced. Then there are other causes of bleeding as well. You see one red currant jelly in interception. You get Meckel's diverticulum, which is another common cause of bleeding per rectum that you have to think of when you get a child. Meckel's diverticulum per se can present with bleeding. It can also present as obstruction or inflammation, and if it is missed at a later age, it can also present as a neoplasm, but I will not go into that, it's not my domain. This rule of two we have all read. It is found in 2% of the population, and out of these two, only 2% will develop symptoms. It mostly presents in the first 2 years of life, and almost all of them will present in the first 20 years of life. Now it is twice as common in males. Chances of developing complications higher if it is longer. It is 2 feet from the ileocecal junction and it is 2 inches of length. So a rule of 2 is very classical in this. One simple Meckel scan can tell you that it is a Meckel's diverticulum. So when you get a patient who is bleeding, mostly painlessly, think of a Meckel scan. It is one very reliable test which can tell you that whether the child is having a Meckel's diverticulum or not. And you can simply laparoscopically do it. You can just get a simple scar on the umbilicus and you can deal with it easily. Now other causes of bleeding PR, some of the non-surgical ones are dysentery, which is very common that you all treat. Bleeding disorders is to be kept in mind when you have a child who is bleeding PR. Then very common cause is fissure, which is associated with constipation. Constipation is like an epidemic nowadays, especially in the affluent society. You get constipation in children very, very commonly, and most of them are associated with fissures. You also get rectal polyps. Interception, again I have already discussed, and Meckel's diverticulum I have already discussed. Fissure, you can see, it is visible from outside. When you see a constipated child and you just retract the buttocks, you can see a fissure. I will show you a photograph. And a polyp is something that you will palpate when you are doing a rectal examination. Fissure will classically have a history of constipation, and the child would have been passing hard stools and will have pain during defecation, where it is not in the case of polyp. In fissure, the blood will come out as streaks which are lining the stool. While in polyps, the bleeding will be separate from the defecation. So you will just have painless bleeding which is coming out, may be with the stools or without the stools also. So this is how a fissure will look. This is a very nice photograph. Normally you don't get such classical things, but yes, this is how a fissure will look. This is a colonoscopic picture of a polyp. A fissure usually does not require any surgery, you just have to treat the constipation. We give some steroid based creams to help this heal along with some sitz bar. And oral dietary changes so that constipation does not recur. Polyp usually removed surgically. Now polyp can come out per rectally. So let's talk about something coming out per rectum in a child. It can be either a rectal prolapse, in which the entire mucosa of the rectum has come out, or it can just be a simple polyp which has prolapsed out of the rectum. So prolapse will look like this, and it can spontaneously regress. Both of them can go back, or sometimes the parents push it back. Now prolapse, usually if you treat the constipation or diarrhea, in some cases treat the malnutrition can be treated conservatively, but if it persists, we do a simple sclerotherapy in which we inject some injections around this which causes fibrosis, and this prolapse is treated, again a daycare procedure. Rectal prolapse is simple, you just have to excise it, tying it at the base. Now again, as I was talking of constipation, it is quite common. Commonest cause is dietary in today's world. Fissure is associated with it. Then you can have children who have cerebral palsy and hypothyroidism who have constipation commonly. But one thing that you should not miss is the Hirschsprung disease. And how do you get pointers? In this, there is a delay, history of delayed passage of meconium. If you ask whether the child passed meconium immediately after birth or not, usually the constipation is refractory to treatment, and it is not hard stool. It is just the patient, the child is not able to pass stool. You usually diagnose it with a barium, in which you see the aganglionic segment is actually collapsed. So this is the part which is not able to push, while the colon which is proximal to it gets dilated because it is trying storing a lot of stool. So what looks abnormal is actually normal. What looks normal is actually abnormal. So that is a dictum in Hirschsprung. This is a classical transition zone, and the treatment is surgical. So that has to be referred to us, and we operate as soon as we get these patients. Then coming from stool, let's move to some urinary problems. Phimosis is again one of the very common ones. Then there are anatomic defects like dystrophy, hypospadias. Then urinary tract infections, again very common in children. We'll see when to deal with them. And voiding disorders and bedwetting, again very commonly seen in children. Now phimosis. Now actually prepuce in children comes back from 1 year to 10 years of age. So till 10 years of age you can say that even if the prepuce is not coming back, it is normal. You don't really need to treat it unless it is causing any problems. Problems in the sense ballooning or recurrent balanoprostatitis. So anywhere between 1 year to around 10 years, it can get retracted on its own. But if it is causing problems, then we can apply some steroid based creams. There is a good Cochrane review over it, and most of them, more than 90% of them, can be treated with a simple clobetasone based cream, and application of them will help you. But if it does not work, then you go for circumcision. But we have seen in practice that more than 90% of them do not require any circumcision, so we usually do not do that. But we usually ask, please do not retract the prepuce forcefully, because what it does is causes a little bit of bleeding, causes a little bit of scarring, and this easy retraction becomes difficult. So just ask them to apply a steroid-based cream, and that works magic. You don't really need to do anything else other than this. But yes, if there are problems, then we can do surgeries like recurrent balanoprostatitis, and if it is not getting treated with steroid-based creams. These are the problems which can happen if you forcefully retract. One of them is paraphimosis, then again it will require a reduction, and this is what happens when you forcefully retract the prepuce. It bleeds, it forms scars when it heals, the child becomes very scared and will not allow you to apply cream also later on, so it becomes difficult. So usually in OPD we should not do it, just start applying creams and it works very well. Hypospadias is when you have the urethral beta somewhere, not at its normal tip but somewhere here. Depending upon position, you can call it proximal or distal. And the repair is usually done at 1 year of age, before the child starts going to school and the child becomes aware of his own genitalia. So this is a distal variant where it has almost reached the glands, while this is a very proximal variant where it is just between the scrotal folds. So next we come on to the urinary tract infections. When do we start investigating once you get a child of urinary tract infection? In a male, even a single culture proven UTI should be investigated, while in females, only when you get recurrent episodes, you start getting investigated. And investigations are the battery of investigations. I'm not going into details of it. As and when what the reports come, you go ahead and do the test. The common things that we deal with is posterior urethral walls in males. Then you get obstruction at the junction of the ureter and the bladder. You can get obstruction at the junction of pelvis and the ureter, which is far more common. And sometimes you can have ureteroseal at the lower end of the ureter, and one very common thing is the vesicoureteral reflux. Now this again is a whole presentation on its own, I'm not going into details of it. Bedwetting, whether we should investigate or not. Secondary bedwetting means the child achieved continence but then again started having bedwetting, you should investigate. But if it is primary, you can still wait. You should treat the underlying 4 to 6 months of age if it is unilateral, and 3 to 4 months if it is bilateral like this. In cleft palate, we operate at around 9 to 18 months. Nowadays, the time is coming less and less. Earlier, it used to be 2 years. Now, it has come down to even 9 months. But that depends on how the child is grown and how well he is developed. You have to remember that such children will have recurrent URTI because they will have regurgitation of the food from the GI tract into the respiratory tract, and will have speech problems, especially if we get the surgery delayed. You commonly encounter these kind of swellings. This is an angular dermoid, this is a thyroglossalsis, these are branchial sinuses, openings in the neck, and you have cystic hygromas. So these are very commonly seen. Normally, dermoid we can operate at around 3 months to 6 months of age. So roughly you can say around 6 months of age, most of the things can be dealt with. most of them will require surgery. They don't go on their own. They keep coming back with recurrent infections if you leave them like that. In cystic hygromas, we can also give injection sclerotherapy, in which you can avoid surgery with that. Sometimes it regresses. If it does not, then we operate and remove this cyst. It can be done somewhere between 6 months to 1 year of age. But hemangioma, especially capillary hemangiomas, hemangiomas are of various variants, but capillary hemangiomas are the one which have a propensity to regress. Normally they appear at infancy, increase till 1 year of age, and they regress to 5 years of age and leave no scar. Nowadays the treatment is to aid this regression with the help of beta blockers, which is very commonly used. You don't need any other treatment. If it doesn't work, you have steroids, you can inject some sclerotherapy, you have lasers, and at the last you can do a surgical excision if it is not doing. Groin swellings we have covered, I'm not going into details of it. But some groin swellings, they do require mention, especially a torsion. So if you get a child who is excessively crying, has some sort of a discomfort, and you miss the testis, that is negligence. You always have to palpate the testis when you have a child in distress, because torsion, if missed, can lead to loss of testis completely. We have had cases who have come shown to some person, but because the child was not pointing out where the pain is, sometimes it gets missed and then we are not able to save the testis. Anyways, the rate of salvage of testis is very low, because he has to be operated within 4 hours of it happening, and it is very rare that the child reaches us in 4 hours. Irreducible hernia and epidermo or PET scan mimic a testicular torsion, but hernia usually will have a history ki pehle se hernia tha and then it got obstructed. It will present with abdominal distension and vomiting more prominently rather than a local tenderness, while in testicular torsion you will have tender red testis scrotal swelling, and it worsens when you elevate it. Now even it is said in our pediatric surgery that even if you operate an epidermo or PET thinking that it is torsion, it is alright, it is part of treatment. You don't have to miss a torsion even if you do a negative surgical exploration, that is acceptable. So for as soon as a torsion comes, we need to operate. You do a scrotal ultrasound only if you think that you can get it done fast, otherwise we just explore directly and do a surgical detorsion. If you get late, you get something like this, which is not salvageable, and we just have to remove the testis. Even then it has to be done, because we have to fix the other side testis, otherwise that has also a chance to get torsion. Undescended testis, again I am not going to cover in details, we have already done that. Umbilical problems we have dealt with. But while we are dealing with umbilical hernia, this is something which needs surgical excision. This is not a granuloma. This is a patent vitreous intestinal duct remnant. So be careful when you are dealing with the granuloma. Granuloma sometimes can also require some amount of cautery to remove. Again, this has been dealt. And one very common thing that we deal with is tongue tie. When do we actually do it? We usually wait till 1 to 2 years of age. Very rarely it causes difficulty in swallowing in the neonatal period, so normally we don't do it at that point of time. And many people do cut it in the OPD, but the ideal treatment which is recommended is to cut this and do a vivaplasty so that it does not recur. Because 99% will not recur, but the 1% that will recur will make our job very difficult. It's very difficult to release it after that. It usually causes some problem in saying the words, jisme talu varn hota hai jo hamare hindi varnmala mein ta tha da da na, because you have to touch your palate with the tongue. Other than that, normally delayed speech is not caused by tongue tie, as normally people feel. It is not a cause of tongue tie. So before we operate, we tell the parents that it's normally not because of this. Thank you for patient listening, and I would it is available. Sometimes there is a long delay just to get a Doppler kulk. Subah khulega, fir karenge.
No, then if you can get it done,
if you can get
that, is ideal.
Yes, ideal.
Rather than opening the child and doing.
No, if you can get it done, best.
2 hours it should be done.
But yeah. But clinically, I think this is a better modality than ultrasound.
Yes, but sir.
See, clinically, you know, we can't diagnose. We have to send it to the surgeon basically.
Yes.
And if a surgeon is not available, at least in the meantime, you can get the ultrasound done. And take a call whether you really require surgery or not. So that's what I think.
If you can do ultrasound within 2-3 hours, it should be.
Yes, if it is available easily, yes. Even we get it done. If it is there, we also make it sure if there is any doubt. But if it is not available, don't delay the
surgery. Suppose it's midnight, you should not wait for that.
Yeah, obviously. Yes. Then you should
send the child. Regarding testicular swellings, nobody mentioned about tumors. Sometimes at the age of 2 years, teratoma can be there.
Yeah, very rightly taken point.
Think about teratoma also, not only hydrocele and hernia.
Yeah, sure, sir. Sure.
And then the difference between scrotal and inguinal scrotal swelling, you can differentiate clinically. If you can get above the swelling, it is caudal, and at you can rule out hernia.
Yes, yes.
If you can't get out of the swelling, then it can be either hernia or hydrocele. Then you have to do ultrasound to differentiate. If you want to be 100% sure, clinically you can differentiate between hydrocele and hernia, but ultrasound should be done if it is in viral disorder.
But clinically, sometimes
there is
a complicating hernia also.
That's why I am saying, if it is in vinous cortex, ultrasound should be done to rule out hernia. And third thing, I will in hernia, pediatric hernia, no role of laparoscopy. It should be just by open surgery, just you have to do herniotomy. Simple surgery, no requirement of mesh as told by him. Just you have to do just one two-stitch operation, and just you have to do herniotomy, no requirement of mesh. No role of laparoscopy here.
So laparoscopy we do. I must tell you, now we have 2 mm instruments also available. Actually, it reduces the size even beyond that. So, and it improves your recovery immensely.
No, but the laparoscopy means you are doing intra-abdominally.
Intra-abdominally, just closing the deep ring from within. And it takes the same amount of time. So that is an option available. How much it improves
I have met many pediatric surgeons, they don't
recommend that. I know that. So there is not a major difference, but still it is an option available. One good thing that it does is it checks the other side also, which unilateral does not do. And right. it makes a huge difference. Sometimes patient does come with recurrence. It does, sir. Sometimes it does.
See, I have a question to you. Yes. Suppose you have unilateral umbilical hernia. Do you operate on one side or both the sides?
Inguinal.
Sir, we operate on one side. The chances of a contralateral recurrence is 5 to 10%. So 90% chance he will not develop a contralateral hernia. So we don't explore if we are doing an open. If somebody is very adamant, we do a laparoscopic. You check both the sides and it's done in the same way. So that is where
I remember there was a pediatric surgeon who used to operate on both the sides. You know, about 20 years back.
Nowadays that has changed, sir.
That's why I wanted your opinion.
Open surgery, no need of.
No, sir. We don't do the other side.
Because laparoscopy is, if it is unilateral, the other side is one of same time.
So 5 to 10%. Yeah. So you can take that 90% chance rather than going 10%, and 90% of times you will not have a sac on the.
Yeah. A small comment on the umbilical, this strawberry, this thing. Umbilical granuloma. See, normally you can all treat it in the OPD using copper sulfate, you know, crystals.
Silver nitrate,
copper sulfate is good enough.
Normal salt,
or even salt also can be used. It has been documented in literature and published in Indian Pediatrics also.
Common salt is one of the modalities.
Common salt is like hypertonic saline, so you can just use it.
You don't have to, you just sprinkle the powder, it will disappear within 2-3 days.
But if inguinal hernia defecting more than 2 cm, would you like to wait?
In umbilical hernia, sir,
defect is more than 2 cm.
Sir, even with the bigger defects, we wait. We have seen it to regress.
After two years of age,
if it after 2 years, we operate, sir.
If the patient. Hirschsprung's disease. Yes. Earlier, we used to do biopsy to see the ganglions.
Yes, sir. No, sir. Right. Biopsy is still the gold standard. Without biopsy, we don't go ahead and do anything. So that rectal biopsy is to be done.
We
do pull through after that.
If the patient comes at the age of 3 or 4 years of undescended testis, what do you do then?
We still do an orchidopexy.
We have missed the bus, but you still have to be done.
We have done it 18 years also, sir. 18 years.
Prevent malignancy.
It does not prevent malignancy there. It is early detection of malignancy.
But why not excise it then?
So whatever hormonal function it probably is left, you leave it.
Other testes is normal.
Yeah, other testes will take care of it. But try explaining it to a parent or even the child. They would want ki nahi sir bacha lo. Nikalne ka bolte hi half of the patients actually sometimes go away. But frankly speaking, even if some hormonal function is present, you can definitely use the testes for that.
But there is a chance of malignancy.
But it will be detected, it comes out. So normally orchidopexy does is it increases your chances of picking up the malignancy. It does not actually decrease it too much. So that is the main aim. So that it is palpable, anything that happens, you can see it immediately. So that is what it does.
Then you will advise annual ultrasound of
suspected? No, sir. Normally we don't do just palpation, manual palpation. That we advise to any adult also. Palpation of the testes, that is all that we advise. Nothing else.
Self-examination plus examination on subsequent visits is definitely advised on the prescription so that it doesn't get missed. Otherwise, the whole idea of doing an orchidopexy will be lost.
Patients will not come for follow-up for a single exam.
Yeah, that is. But
you have to explain to the either parent.
Compliance is always a problem with us. But still, from our side, we can do what is ideal.
For orchidopexy, do you do in one stage or two stages?
Yes. Should you reduce it by opening book style?
What, sir?
Asana pistis.
Yes.
Should you try to open the book style reduction?
We, sir, give a midline incision on the scrotum.
No, not surgical. Yeah.
Surgically, yes, both the sides we have to do it, open the book.
No,
I understand. What you're talking of is under fluoroscopic guidance or ultrasound guidance, you derotate
it. The patient is coming to us. So we simply reduce it by
without opening it.
It cannot be done like that. Sometimes fluoroscopy was advised to do under fluoroscopy and you try to derotate it, but that's not gone out of vogue. It's completely gone out of vogue. And that, sir, depends on whether we can pull down, what depends on the lens or the testicular vessel. If it is good enough, we do it in one stage. Mostly we are able to do it in one stage, but there are times we have to do it in two stages also.
And regarding phimosis,
yes, sir.
Majority of the time you just open with the artery forceps and the patient becomes all right.
Yes, sir, I know with your experienced hands you will be able to do it, but sometimes some people don't have that much of finesse. They injure it more rather than doing it. You have done it multiple times, yes, you can do it, but yes. Sometimes people injure the prepuce, then that makes our job a little more difficult. That's
more fibrosis.
Infancy, phimosis is really very common.
Mostly
infancy, we've seen phimosis to the extent of 30-40% of the babies coming with phimosis. But in our experience, we've not really seen any baby actually requiring a surgical correction or phimosis leading to some complications like balanitis. So, surgical intervention, we believe, is definitely
only
not
there important. Is a problem. So that's why I said up to 10 years we can just wait if it is not causing any problems. It is physiological. It is not going to get retracted in all children. Unless it is causing problems only.
Unless and until there are UTIs, there is a documented very poor urinary stream. Then you think of
after opening it with the forceps, like the way you do it, doesn't the child require regular retraction for 3-4 days after that? That's not your opinion.
Not after that. Maybe after a week's time. Then
it'll be a painful thing after that, you know.
Immediately,
what is your experience?
Immediately there is a painful. It's painful procedure.
Uh-huh.
But surgically, 4-5 days time, you can retract it completely.
You should be retracted after opening it out.
Yeah. And easily. About 80% of the cases they become all right.
Dr. Aparna, since when this nomenclature of abnormal uterine bleeding has come? Earlier we used to call
it. We used to call it DUB, now it is not. It has changed. FIGO has changed it almost. It's been a lot of time now.
What is the cost of doing an undescended testis in your setup? Cost?
Orchidopexy. So it will cost around 40,000 to 50,000 the one day to this day.
Is regarding cervical cancer screening.
Please
hold
the mic.
You said if the woman ages 21 years, there is no need for screening. If she is sexually active at the age of 16 or 17 years, should we go for the screening?
So the American Society of Detection of Cancers has even put it as 21 years of age. So where the sexual promiscuity is much more than what is seen in India. So ideally we assume that any lady who is less than 21 is ideally not sexually active, but then a pap smear is ideally required for anybody who has become sexually active. So ideally we have kept it at 21 years. They are actually sexually active before 21. Before 21 also. But then see, even the US has not changed the recommendations. So even the Indian FIGO, so even our FOXI has not changed the recommendations. But I believe pap smear screening is required for anybody who is sexually active. And I believe vaccination is advised for everybody who is.
How much vaccination is protecting cervical cancer?
Very important.
It's very effective. See, 97% of all the cervical cancers are caused by HPV vaccine.
Yes.
So if you vaccinate against HPV virus, it is effective.
Okay.
But at a particular age.
Ideally, the vaccination should be given before the girl is sexually active.
Before
the girl is sexually active.
10 years. Starting with 10 years.
Ideally, you should.
9 to 49.
Okay. Ideally, 9 to 45 vaccination years. Should be done. The best time is pre-pubertal. If you start at 10 years, that is the best time. Because you get the best seroconversion at that time. And nowadays, since the last 1 year or so, American Academy of Pediatrics says you give only 2 doses to children less than 14 years of age. So once they are 15 plus, you need 3 doses, as like adults. But less than that, you need only 2 doses. So robust is the seroconversion before that time. So the ideal time is to do it around 10 to 12 years of age. As early as possible to get best seroconversion rates.
Sir, but which one is your experience about it?
Gardasil.
See, if you use a 2 dose, it protects against cervical cancer. The 4-valent vaccine, both are actually equally good, but the 4-valent vaccine will give you protection against multiple problems. Like, you know, vulval cancer.
Head and neck cancers. Okay. Cervical cancer. So they're the same everywhere, and we're going to have a nonavalent vaccine soon, so that will cover 9 strains of HPV.
Professor, HPV vaccine, when will it start in males to prevent oropharyngeal?
See, males is advocated in a number of countries, including one country which is Australia, you know.
Australia,
but in India, we are not even able to give it to the females, you know, leave alone the males. So let us cover the primary sufferers first, at least. Then we'll come to secondary transmission.
Respiratory
papillomatosis, we are giving it. Yeah. Must be. I'm not aware of that.
You can afford private.
New things you learn in BFI.
It is available free of cost for government school girls. It is available free of cost for government school kids. So if they show that they are in class 6 or 7, if they go with their ID and their Aadhaar card, it is given free in some...
In three centers
in Delhi. They are given free of cost. And for a private, for like if your child is not in a government school, it is given at a cost of 900 rupees to the girl. So it is not very cheap, it's not very expensive for girls. So if you're a government school child, it comes free. And if you are a private school girl, then it comes at 900 rupees, which is pretty decent. And the vaccines are going waste, so might as well send all your patients there. Nobody is getting the vaccination done.
So with this friend, I would like to express my thanks to Dr. Vishu first, Dr. Alus, and Dr. Deepali, Dr. Apanda Srimudana, and Dr. Shireen Massey, ma'am. Please come here, ma'am. As I always do, I would request Dr. Shireen to sum up this CME from Gynae point of view, ma'am, please.
As for pediatrics, the Gynae's talk was also very broad spectrum. She has covered all the Gynae problems, especially useful for general practitioner in a short and precise manner.
Thank you. Thank you.